And welcome, welcome, welcome to Sessions with Stef. This is a podcast that I do bi-weekly on the Likumbari channel. It's a podcast that I am enjoying while I do it. I'm having a blast doing it. I invite musicians, friends, people that have been in the business for years, or maybe not years, but people that play music, people that are in the music business. I have them perform on the podcast. I talk about what they do, talk about their instrument. I talk about if they have any original projects that they're doing. And I'm really loving doing this. I do this, like I said, on the Likumbari channel, where we have some skits and we have an episodic TV show, I guess TV show, YouTube show, we'll call it. And it's a lot of fun. This is also in association with JJR Studios and our producer, Louis, who is here. And I also have Lisa and Luigi and Francesca here helping out. This week, on my podcast, I'm another friend of mine. This is going to be fun. We play together. We have played together. We are playing together currently. It's a little different because every other podcast that I've done has featured singing. Today, we're going into an instrument. Today, we're going to talk about beautiful instrument, an instrument I love. It's the backbone. Well, no, I'm going to say drums is the backbone. That's because I play drums. But we're going to talk bass. We're going to talk about his project. Ladies and gentlemen, I am introducing to you Daniel DiCintio. Very good
friend of mine. Hello,
hello. Hello, Dan. How's it going, man? I have good. A beer. You have a beer?
I do.
Where's your beer?
Hold on. Here it is. Ching, ching.
Ching, ching.
Salute.
Chen Dan. So guys, this is Daniel. We met a couple of years ago. I love playing with this guy.
It's already, how long is it we know each other?
It was
I think 7 years. My first year in McGill. Yeah.
Seven years?
Yeah, because, when I first entered McGill, it was right when I started dating my girlfriend. It's already 7 years.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
I thought I was your girlfriend. Sorry. 7 years. Wow. Is it? So, because basically, We met New Year's Eve, right?
It was New Year's Eve, but I just entered the McGill University. I remember I was practicing for a job that I had to do. And I remember I was going over some top 40 music. I don't remember what I had to do.
But I remember what you had to do.
Yeah, I probably remember too.
I'm going to explain the story of how we met.
Well, okay, go for it.
It's through a mutual friend.
Yeah, exactly.
So a friend of mine, Sharda, said, hey, you got to check out this dude. He's Italian. So I said, oh, I don't know if I want to go with one of those again. But no, I went with, and she said, he loves bass. And it just so happened we needed a bass player for New Year's Eve.
Well, actually, what it was is that I remember I was back at Vanier. It was my last year. And I think it was actually the summer before going to McGill. And I was practicing at school because, that's what I did.
That's what you do.
Yeah, exactly. I had no choice. And Sharda was in the basement, one of the practice rehearsals in the basement at Vanier. And Sharda knocked on my door. And she said, hey, you're playing pop music, electric bass. Because at the time, I was studying upright bass at Vanier. So I decided, hey, let me start going back to my roots. Because I started off on electric bass, in my long hair days and my jean jacket. And
what? You went through that too?
I was 14 years old. I had my earring. I had my patches, Iron Maiden, like 666.
Yeah, man. Wars,
even though I'm scared of a fly, but I was supposed to be a... I was supposed to be a badass, put that aside. So she came to my room, said, yeah, I have a friend. I think she mentioned, no, she didn't mention you, but she said,
no, impossible. She definitely mentioned.
Not your name in particular. Gotcha. She mentioned, I used to play in a band called Cheers. And yeah. I said, yeah, I think I've heard of that band. Like it started getting me I was very interested, excited about the conversation because that's something I always wanted to do. I always wanted to have, I've always loved entertaining people. I always loved, for me, my biggest pleasure is seeing people dance. you know, because of the music the band is making
live
at that moment. And so anyway, she told me her story and everything. And then, yeah, I went to Vanier and then, McGill. And I got a call from you and you're like, hi, is this Daniel? Yeah, something like that. Anyways, regardless.
Well, the funny part is this is, of course, this is the way we do it. Or whatever, back in those days. Well, it's only 7 years ago, but the band. So it's New Year's Eve, and we have, I don't know, 400 or 500 people there. So,
yeah, something like that. More
and
or
we
less.
Call a sub bass player, which is Daniel. I haven't even met the guy, but Sharda, which is a very good friend of mine. She's a fantastic singer. She will be on the show, guaranteed.
Oh yeah, okay, great.
She definitely will be on the show. And she's, you know, she recommended. So I don't even. I just call. Are you free? And he's like, yeah. And we didn't even do a rehearsal. It was like nothing. Here's the 150 songs we play. We'll see you on stage.
Honestly, what it was, I don't even remember what my emotion. I just remember being so excited. I was so happy. I was 20 years old. It was gonna be the first time I was gonna play with a big party.
Did you
band.
Guys? Did you guys hear that? 20 years old.
I was 20. I was.
20 years old.
I was 20 years old, and I was so excited because I've always wanted to play in a party band and like. You know, pretty much when Stefano called me, he said, okay, you know, my brother's going to send you the music, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. I don't remember. I think I got in contact with the main bass player at the time.
Who did we have? Fabi?
No, Gabriel.
Oh, Gabrielle was
there.
Yeah, Gabrielle.
Exactly. So very, very sweet person, very professional. Yeah, she's awesome. And she sent me all the music, and I spent like 2 months just, I remember, because you called me, it must have been October, like 2 months just going every day, going over every single tune, every single, just practicing it. And we had No practice, no rehearsals. I didn't know anybody. And it was, again, the first time I'm playing with a big band, and I was so used to, you know, being in the jazz world. And I do the little
quote-unquote jazz world.
I was thinking more like bunny ears, but yeah quote-unquote jazz world, if whatever you want to call that. But anyways, yeah, and I got to the gig. It was at, where was it? Le Baron.
Was it? Yeah.
Regardless, but anyways.
I've done New Year's Eve for the past...
20 years, 25 years?
No, more than that. If I'm 45, it's got to be 30 years at least.
When you were 15?
I was 15.
No. Couldn't be that young.
No. I was with Eclipse. This is a band that didn't last long. Yeah, the band was called Eclipse. I think I was 16. So maybe 29. Yeah, I was 16. I played New Year's Eve at Rose Rose in La Salle. That was.
I remember you told me the story. I was there. Yeah, you told me.
And needless to say, you came on as a 20-year-old. And no, but it's true because we were impressed.
About it,
we got on stage and said, okay, he's all shy. He came in with his hat. He's all shy. Puts his bass on and he grooves, man, without practice. And then the band did the job. And but because we know what it is. Obviously, we didn't go above and beyond to say, let's have a rehearsal. we just said, come on.
God forbid.
Crash and burn, man. Exactly. He's going to make mistakes. Don't worry.
But you know what? Honestly, we must have played, 80 to 100 tunes that night, for sure. And it went well. It went, I have to say, for the first time, for
7 years later, you're still playing. You play with us. I play with you. Yeah, we play in every, I think we're in every project together.
More or less, yeah. At that point.
There's one band that I play in that you're not in.
That's it.
Which is Sandra's band, which is a Latin band.
Yeah, no, but that's exactly it.
Otherwise, you do your jazz.
But not, jazz that's stuff. It. That's just, yeah, exactly.
Well, they're jazz gigs and stuff. Okay, cool. Well, look, before I ask more questions, okay, because we just like to have performances on the show. So before I ask more questions and we go more in depth here. Yeah. I want to show you guys just how much he grooves.
Oh, man.
But now, because we don't have a singer, I came up with a different idea. And I think this is going to be pretty cool. First thing is he doesn't even know what he's going to play. I'm going to play a track. I prepared a couple of tracks. So what I did is I put 3 songs and I cut them up, like just a verse chorus of each song. I'm pretty sure he knows them. Hopefully by heart. I guess we'll know on the
podcast. I didn't forget them. Hopefully not.
So he doesn't know. I just want to show you guys how he grooves, how he plays the bass, how he does pop music or any kind of music for that matter. And I'm going to play the track. It's going to switch in the middle, but he's going to play along with the 3 songs. It's basically verse, chorus, and then end. And it's going to be the first time he hears it. And listen to how he grooves. Then we'll talk about what goes into how he grooves. So let's check this out, man.
Okay.
This is going to be interesting.
let's see. Oh, okay.
You nailed it. That was great.
Thank you.
That was, you know what's impressive? I'm going to tell you as a, okay, I mean, there's, because I've played with tons of people. There's the jazz world. There's the pop world. There's the rock world.
The Latin world.
The Latin
that's
world.
That's a world on
its, that's a world on its own. So for sure. There's a lot of different worlds. And generally, like you went to McGill, right? You studied at Vanya. You went to McGill.
Yeah, that's right.
And generally, that world uses charts for everything.
Absolutely.
And I admire that. It's phenomenal.
Right.
You're one of the only ones I've seen that you don't really. You don't. Well, like you. I think you made it a point to memorize every song, and it's impressive. That's why I'm doing this. I'm not even telling him the keys. He's just like, nah, let's play,
man. You know what it is, man? For me, my idea is this. If you're playing in I'm going to call it a show band. If you're playing in a show band, the whole purpose is to entertain the people in front of you. Now, if you're just looking in front of you at a chart the whole time,
I agree.
How are you supposed to entertain? And when you're going to watch a concert at Club Soda, the Bell Center, Metropolis, etc., are the artists looking at charts? No, they're not. They're there to entertain you. So why are you going to look at a chart? The whole thing is, listen to the song. If you have the melody stuck in your head, you're going to hear the bass movement. You're going to hear where the chords are going all the time. Of course, that being said, I make mistakes.
No, well,
that's
course.
Only that's, normal. That's normal. Like that's right life. Now, I made a couple mistakes here and there. And I'm laughing about it. I'm smiling.
That's part of it. It's going to happen. That's normal. But, you know, and I used to have, because, you know, I read quite a bit. But, you know, I'm a hybrid. Like I kind of
do both.
I try to listen. I guess maybe with experience, I kind of get. So, like, sometimes I would see some guys playing Italian music, you know?
Right.
I'm like, dude, it's three chords. You're reading a chart. just listen to the singer, and you're going to be able to follow where they're going. But they panic without it. I'm like, oh, that's schooling, you know. But then again, I understand it, because when there's 500 songs in your head, sometimes you just need that crutch. And yes. I made it when I was first started, like 18, 19 years old, I'd be playing. The first time I played a song, if I used the chart, I think I needed the chart every gig. I needed it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I would have 100 songs in my head, and that one song, I would have to go and get the paper and put it in front of me.
It's true, no.
It became a crutch. I'm like, but why? So I would make it a point to almost not use the chart the first time.
Right.
And just play with it until I remember the chords without looking at the chart and remember them.
Well, you know what? You brought up a good point, because I do that with one particular song, How Deep Is Your Love by the Bee Gees. And I've played it so many times. It's unbelievable. And to this day, I still need a chart because I'm nervous about making mistakes.
It's funny.
And the reason is because, let's say one of the songs I did, Boogie Wonderland, there's a specific groove, a specific bass line. But when you have a tune like How Deep Is Your Love, you're really, it's like learning a jazz standard where you have a chart with a bunch of chords on it.
Yeah.
So for me, it's like, there's so many different chords, not a specific bass line. So to memorize all those chords, I have a harder time.
Of course.
So compared to just memorizing, let's say, the movement of just a standard ostinato bass line that repeats over and over again, et cetera, with a few embellishments.
You know, that's the difference between like jazz. I love all styles of music. So when I'm playing jazz, like you said, million chords, and tons of changes.
That's right.
Pop, most of the time you got like six chords or four chords.
Exactly.
The way you, I guess in jazz, it's the same thing. It's all about the swing and it's all about the feel.
But pop is the same thing.
Yeah, but a lot of musicians don't look at that. Like, they just, oh, it's repeated, and they just repeat it. No,
that's
man. It's unfortunate.
There's a
verse, there's a chorus, and if there's a bridge, you got to build a song like a jazz tune,
100%.
like any other tune. You know, if you don't build a song and respect, even those four chords, you got to play those four chords differently.
Respect the music. Take 100%. A tune like, here on top of my head, If I Ain't Got You by Alicia Keys.
Sure.
For me, I take that tune, and the first thing I think of is a beautiful couple dancing. You know, it's a slow dance, and you want to serenade that beautiful couple. So when it comes to like the intro is calm, and then when the verse picks up and the bass comes in, it's like you want to give that impact. And when the chorus comes in, you want to really elevate it. You want to do that climax and then bring it down back when the verse.
This is getting deep, man. This is getting really deep.
Yeah, absolutely. And like I tell my musicians that a lot. Like a lot of times we're rehearsing, I'll say, guys, you know. And they're all fantastic musicians, some better than me, for that matter. And, you know, that's always a point I bring about. So when we're playing pop music, like, listen to the singer.
You have to.
He or she has to shine.
Yeah.
Not the bass player, not the drummer. Support them. By supporting them, the crowd's looking at them.
It's
they're
all
listening
about
them, to
of
them.
Of course. It's
like we're just the I'm like the salt.
Even though all the songs chosen are all bass heavy songs.
Yeah,
what can I say?
No, what do you want to do?
When you're doing covers, do you approach it your way, or do you approach it as to what the original composer did? Or the original bass player, let's say, and do you kind of try to copy him, or do you approach it a little differently and say?
Good question. If I'm doing a recording, I'll try to stick to it as much as possible. If I'm playing live, depending on the size of the band, if I'm playing with a really big band, I'll try to keep it simple because there's always already so much going on. But can I give an example?
Sure,
like,
of course.
Play an example.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
So let's say we take a tune like, here, we'll take a bass line. Sorry if I'm speaking really close into the mic.
Okay.
Take Bad Girls, Donna Summer.
Donna
Summer's always confused. Yeah. So the bass, the tune is in D minor, okay? So the bass line off the track, like when I learned it, I'll see if I can just get the basic bass line. Like okay, intro then. Right?
Yep.
Very simple.
Yeah.
But if I'm playing with the band, let's say my band, your brother's band, a smaller band, whichever.
Yeah.
I'll take the bass line, I'll try to embellish it a bit more. So I'll go like. Like little things.
You make it your own.
Little things like that, just because I want people to dance.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, people are going to dance. If the bass is groovy,
100%.
People are going to, same for the drums and the bass have to be together.
It all has, but honestly, the drummer is holding it together, like timing wise.
Absolutely.
The bass, if when the bass grooves, it adds a certain, you got to groove, you got to be in the pocket. Drums, 100%. Bass, it's all about that.
It's those little embellishments that just like,
100%.
To me, the biggest compliment is after doing, let's say, a corporate event, a wedding, and I like someone that's not a musician, comes up to me and says, man, the bass was just happening. And the first thing I tell them is, my eyes get really big, like, wow, I say is,
you noticed.
Like, you noticed? Like, yeah, man, like, it was just making me dance all night. And I'm like,
true.
First thing I say is, good, I did my job. Yeah. I am so happy to hear that.
Speaking of that, I'm going to bring this in. Because...
Go for it. Go for it, man.
Okay. I want to bring up Soul Station Orchestra.
Yeah, of course.
So Daniel is the owner of Soul Station Orchestra. Right. He started, what is it, 3 years now that you...
No, to be honest, well, 3 years when I started working with Veronica, my partner, my...
Life partner.
My lover partner.
Ah, that's the way that I love it.
Also my work partner, yes.
Can I tell you something? I got to tell you right away. Yeah. Without her, you're nothing, bro. You're a great bass player.
What do you want me to...
No. She's got her shit together.
100%.
You guys complement each other.
I was just going to say that.
And it works so well.
But look, you know what? Let me say something. Like us two, yes, we both have our jobs. She's fantastic at marketing and... I do a lot of the other stressful stuff that comes with having a
she
business.
She does the fun stuff with the pictures and the videos.
Fine,
But you know what? When you say fun, there's a lot of
there's
work.
There's a lot of work.
That.
I was just going to say that.
A lot of work.
A ton of work. And she just has an eye that I don't. And I'm not interested in the whole marketing thing. But
that makes
not that I'm not interested in it, but she's just much better than
I am. That's how you run a business. I mean, you're an entrepreneur now. You've started your own business. You started your own band. And you've got to get people that know what they're doing because you can't handle all of it.
You know what?
You can't. So, if you're doing the band, if you're running the band or you're running the music
you
or you're getting...
You can't do everything, man.
The marketing is going to take a hit.
It's not even just the... Look, you hit the nail on the head. It's like I remember once you told me, I was just going to repeat what you just said. Like everybody in the group, in our group, I always tell them, even though you... work for me and even though I pay you at the end of the night, we are a team. Everybody has their job. Everybody has their individual job. I don't do everything, and without you guys, not that to say I can't work, but we all complement each other and we all have our specific roles and you're all good at what
100%.
You do
100%.
That's what it is.
100%. So it has to be that way.
It's a team, just like any other company. You have those key players within the team.
Do you find it a challenge running a band?
Well, just from my facial expression, I think it says it all. 100%. It's very, look, how do I say this? It's very rewarding. It's very, very rewarding when I have, let's say let's take a wedding, for example. We'll use a client that, you know, is getting married. I've had some couples that literally change their wedding day just so that they can have a band at their wedding.
Yeah.
And to me, it's, that tells me, how do I say this? Not in a cocky way because I'm the last guy to be cocky. The band sounds good. It looks good. And, you know, it's in demand. And I'm super happy because there hasn't been, let's say, in my generation, there's no bands that are, like, there's nobody starting bands in my age because not everybody wants to take the risk.
And I'm going to tell you right away off the bat because I come from the generation a little bit before that.
Yeah.
We used to have the Let's Get Married book here
in
Montreal.
Right, yeah.
Every band would.
Mario knew.
And honestly, you would open up this book and the band section would come in. There was 100 bands. Like, I mean, I could rattle off 40 bands off the top of my head.
And I believe you, 100%.
But no one. And then throughout the years, eventually DJs came into play.
Correct.
Because when I started, you weren't allowed to have a DJ at a wedding.
It just didn't look good.
It didn't look good, right?
Now
you're allowed. Of course, DJs are doing well, and it's great.
Right.
That's the way the rest of the market is in Canada.
Right.
And even in the States. And now, there's no young... You're right. One taking la relève, you know what I mean?
No, sorry to cut you off, and I was just going to say that really the biggest factor why a lot of people my age don't want to start is, one, they don't want to do the work to start it because it's a ton of work and a lot of hurdles you have to cross between dealing with people, you know, projects, videos, and the biggest thing is the money you have to spend. But I was happy I took that risk because it's doing well.
Yeah, it is.
And I like to say, like, now it's doing well. We'll see in 10 years. But I have to say that I'm very, very confident that, you know, that we'll definitely be, you know, up there in the next few years. If not, in the next 2 years, once this
COVID, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. 100%. But, yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to have definitely more questions. But
yeah,
you know what? I want to hear you play, man.
Yeah, okay.
Well, this is going to be the second track.
Well, there's another track. I didn't know.
This is another track. This is a track I prepared. There's three songs. He has no idea which songs they are.
I really don't.
Verse chorus. I believe I did verse chorus. Yeah. So I'm just going to play it, and you play along with it. I want to groove, man. I want to groove.
Well, if I don't know it, I'm making mistakes. Well, I apologize.
This is going to freak you out, guys. Was a lot of fun, guys. I love that. This, like, just to say, he had no idea what the songs were. And I can imagine, I already know
that. The only thing running through my head was like, okay, man, I have to know this for this weekend. I'm like, okay.
It's true. I know he's played them before. And obviously, I picked pretty bass-heavy grooves because I love them.
Yeah.
And I know he can rip the shit out of them because I've heard him do it.
Thank you.
So speaking of Soul Station, I mean, first thing, let's talk about, you have different services with the band, right?
Yeah, of course. You know, when we first started, I had my first partner, obviously that didn't go too well. Well, I started on my own when I was 19, and it was called Sunny Moon for Two. Don't ask. I have no idea.
I'm going to say now I know why it didn't go so well. I'm joking.
No. But you know what? I like to think of these experiences as good experiences, because if you don't go through these experiences, you just don't know.
Of course.
You have to. You have to. These are hurdles. These are good stresses. And, sorry, what was your question again?
No, the
services, So in terms of the services, like currently what we offer, we start with the basics. So let's say we have our string trio. String trio is the string quartet. So that entails your violin, viola, and cello. The repertoire is consisting of, a lot of people just think of classical music, right? Because obviously you look in movies and, you know.
And let me just say that it's Veronica who.
That's right.
That's her department. She takes care of the string trio.
That's her department, especially when it comes to ceremonies.
Yeah.
So they do a lot of wedding ceremonies and a lot of dinners. A lot of people hire them for dinners, private events at houses.
Amazing.
And which is, to me, it's a beautiful thing, you know, to have that. Secondly, I have my, what's called the Ultra Lounge Band.
Ooh.
The Ultra Lounge Band, pretty much, we used to just really do jazz standards, and I realized, like, you know, people, not that they don't want to hear that, but, you know, after two or three songs, it just goes past over their head. Excuse me. Sorry. But nowadays, we really just stick to pop music and...
With a jazz feel.
Not even with a jazz feel. Even though I'm playing upright bass... I stick to the bass line as closely as possible, even though at the end of the night, my fingers have huge blisters. In terms of that group, like, really, again, focuses on dinners, corporate events, like a lot of Sanka sets. So it's essentially conventions. For example, we used to do a Canopy Growth. Could it be Canopy Growth? Yeah, which they're
a big marijuana
company, I guess you can say that, in Canada. So they used to have a lot of doctors from across the world used to come and do their conventions. So we used to do their dinners.
Okay.
So they're strong on that, being the Ultra Lounge. We have multiple little bands of the Ultra Lounge, like subdivisions. And then, of course, we have our DJ, which, you know, I don't push it, but when people do call, if they have smaller budgets, I'll give them hire my DJ. And then, of course, we have my favorite, our show band, which is 7 to 10 piece, which is the 7 pieces are 3 singers, 2 female singers, 1 male singer, what our rhythm section. And then our 10-piece, which is my favorite because we have our horn section. Yeah.
3-piece horn section,
Three-piece horn section. Trombone, saxophone, and trumpet.
It's fun. It's a lot of fun.
It's a lot of fun. But then again, it's a lot of work having a 10-piece band between setting up, sound check, all the charts, like getting all the charts, writing all the charts, etc. But... It's the biggest reward is seeing people smiling when they're on the dance floor. To me, that's the biggest thing, you know?
And I'm going to plug this because I already know this.
Plug.
We play together in the big band, of course. We also play with December Rose.
She is
one of the singers.
That's right.
In Soul Station.
Correct.
And we also back up her independent music project, which is a lot of fun.
It's nice to do original music sometimes.
Music is music.
Well, yeah. When I say sometimes, I meant to say that when I get the chance to do it, I'm always happy to do it.
My whole career has been a bit of everything.
Correct.
It keeps me going. I enjoy it more. I look forward to gigs because it's, you know, sometimes you do the same thing over and over.
It becomes repetitive.
You know, I remember bands back in the wedding bands when there was 100 of them.
Oh my God.
You would look at one band and you would see them 1 year and they sound good. You know, you're like, wow. You'd see them, you'd run into them 5 years later at the hall.
The same repertoire.
And it's the same songs and you're like, shit, don't you get tired? Like, I saw that 5 years ago, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't know. I love playing a jazz trio here for a little gig, cocktail gig. I love the big show band. I love independent music like December Rose. That's a fun thing.
Because it really makes you, especially like original music, it really makes you be the musician, to be creative.
Exactly.
You don't have to follow that Shit, exactly. The song sounds like this, has to be like this. Yeah. No, you get to put your own...
100%. Put your own spice.
Your spice. That's yeah, it, exactly, you know.
So I'm going to plug the Big Show Band because we have a gig. Now, generally, you'd have to be at a wedding or a corporate event to see to see us play.
Right.
But now we have one a gig coming up.
Yeah, it's going to be starting, if not weekly, probably once a month. If I'm not too sure, but...
Well, we can say September 11th, we're playing, September guaranteed. 11th
is, yes, absolutely.
So in Laval, we have there's a place called Sharks.
Sharks, that's correct.
And it's in Centropolis, apparently. I haven't been there, but apparently
it's a really chic, nice place.
Like it's a tapas bar with a bowling alley.
Yeah, they have disco bowling.
Bowling and all. And we're Soul Station will be playing on September 11th, which is fun because generally... You know, we do weddings, we do corporate.
It's different.
Which is fun, and I love it. But this type of gig is going to... I'm looking forward to it.
100%. Definitely. It's definitely nice to play. Like Stefano said, when it's not a wedding corporate, you know, it's you know, usually you're used to playing, like, bars, pubs, and, like, which is not always the nicest, I have to say.
Yeah, it depends.
But
you know,
seeing this place, very exciting because it looks like a super clean, non-sketchy place, like, very... Yeah.
And for us, it's going to be fun.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be fun. 100%.
People can come that don't normally see Soul State. Like I said, you have to be invited to a wedding to see us or be part of a company that we're playing
That's
for.
That's great. In this case, it's
open to the public. So I'm going
to
plug that. That's September 11th.
Yeah, at Sharks. Yeah, that's right. So that's S-H-A-R-X.
In Laval. I'm curious to see the place too.
Yeah, me too.
But mind you,
all jokes aside,
I am going to say it's a smaller band because obviously.
Yes, it is a 5-piece band because of, obviously.
Kind budget can break. Yeah. One day they might.
You don't know. We'll exactly. You might have of course.
We used to play back in the day at Bourbon's all the time. It was a lot of fun.
Back when it existed.
Back when it existed. It was bad. Such a good.
I heard.
Just to change the vibe around, you know, you're used to the weddings and and they're fun. But like I said, you know,
weddings could be a lot of pressure.
What's hard about a wedding and corporate is, well, corporate's a little different because you don't always play dinner. But weddings, you play like literally at 6 o'clock and you're stopping at like 1:30 in the morning. So you got to give energy, but you got to conserve a little bit because it's a marathon. You're playing.
You're exhausted.
And you're exhausted.
Oh, yeah.
Whereas here, when you're playing 3 sets of 45 minutes, it's like, bang, you give it all you got.
Exactly.
And it's fun because you get to give it all you got all at once. You don't have to, like,
100%. No, 100. I agree with you on that for sure.
Okay. Next thing I'm going to do, this is a segment I do on my show all the time. Whoever's on the show, I do a little game.
Okay.
It's a game called First Thought.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
So what I do is I throw something out. I say something to you. I'm going to say your favorite something. You're this. You're some. And you have to say your first thought when I mention this.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Okay.
There's 10 items. I might make fun of you, but that's part of the game.
Go for it. Yeah.
And I'm curious to see what comes out fast. You got a couple of seconds to answer. So here's an example, and it's very easy. Favorite food.
Souvlaki. I don't know. I panicked.
Dude, you panicked from wait to the end.
I was going to say pizza. I just panicked in my head. I don't know.
Is it pizza or souvlaki?
I'm going to go with souvlaki.
You're going to go? Wow, that's impressive.
Yeah, you don't know why? Because you don't have souvlaki often.
Your mother's going to kill you when you get home.
Nah, but after having pizza so many times, put this aside.
All right. You know, my go-to, for some reason, I like Chinese food.
I was going to say Chinese food. I
think it's because we're so used to the same cuisine that when you get that chance, you're going to go out to have something different.
You know, I'll be honest with you. You know what my favorite food is? Now that I just thought about it.
Yeah.
I know you're going to laugh, but like beans and rice. It's simple, but like it makes me feel good after eating it. I know it sounds weird.
Wow.
Like not even for taste. Sometimes I have like certain foods, I get an upset stomach because I'm not used to eating it.
Uh-huh.
But beans and rice. I feel like Popeye.
And how's the next morning?
Well... I should say it's interesting.
It's interesting.
Exactly.
All right. Okay. So see, the first one wasn't that hard.
No.
Kind of. I don't know. You said 3 different answers, but it wasn't that hard. favorite movie. That's easy.
Oh, Goodfellas.
Nice.
Yeah, man. You want to know why?
Because of the trunk scene when the trunk is open?
No. You don't want to know why? I love old cars. It's not the whole muscle car thing, the Camaros and the Firebirds. Like, I don't care about the speed. To me, it's just where it came from, the years that it came from, the style, you know, the music of the time. It's just, It's so, like, it's mechanical. Like, nowadays, cars today, I know I'm going off topic, but
no, it's funny because usually musicians, like myself, not for my car, if I can hear the bass in the system, for me, it's a good car.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Like
that's what I care about.
Like, a car I drive every day, I don't care what I have because, you know, whatever. It's just an everyday car. But besides that, yes, first, I just like it because stylistically, they just look very eloquent.
Okay.
Yeah, elegant. Okay. Sorry, not eloquent. Sorry, cool. I'm tired.
Anyway, so yeah. We went on to cars, but that was favorite.
Sorry
movie.
About that.
No, I love it. I love it. Okay. Favorite concert?
You know what? It has to be... Okay. Probably at the Jazz Fest. Probably the Jazz Fest. It was a big band that I saw. Mm-hmm. Let's just say I, you know... There was the Puff the Magic Dragon, and let's just say that.
Just say
whatever.
The band could have been good.
No, but you know what? My favorite concerts are always smaller venues and like outdoors.
So what band was it?
I don't remember. It was a big band. It was.
Jesus
I think
Christ,
it was actually,
you don't remember. It's your favorite it was, concert.
Was,
you don't. Remember.
I think it was the. It wasn't my favorite, but it was one of the most memorable. I remember. It
That's because you were so high.
No, I'm joking. It was on. It was what's it called? Christine Jensen Big Band. She's a professor at McGill. Christine,
yes,
she's a sax player.
Yes,
sax player.
I know Christine
That's right.
Jensen. Yeah.
And there was this. They were playing a ballad, and there was a sax player playing this solo. And I remember just being. I think I was even tearing up, as funny as that sounds, because it was just so beautiful. I think his name,
I'm glad you prefaced it by saying Puff the Magic.
No, but the sax player, I think his name André Leroux, but he's what a beautiful sax player. Like, anyways, it was just amazing. But I have to say, compared to seeing like Stevie Wonder.
Really?
Well, just because the sound of the Bell Center.
You like the small venue kind of thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sound wise. I want to hear everything.
That's
you
respectable.
Know?
That's respectable.
That's it.
Okay. Cool. This is going to be funny. What's your first thought when I bring up this name? Kenny G.
You know what? I watched videos of him when he started in the early 80s.
Uh-huh.
Amazing.
Wow.
And his band was phenomenal. Even him as a sax player. And I find he really did a smart move by going towards the more... general, you know,
general cheesy.
Sorry, you know what, man? The guy, I'm
surprised.
He does well for himself. He did a very smart move.
I always say, you know, it's funny when you, I'm asking this because I know you came from the jazz world.
That's right.
99.999%
laugh,
of
you know
they
what?
Would laugh.
You know what? People are laughing. I think he's laughing.
Oh, he is.
When he goes to the bank,
it's like Metallica, right? Yeah. It's like Metallica when. A lot of people always laugh at that, you know, the Black Album. Oh, they sold out. Yeah, but you know what?
I bought a copy. Like, come on.
You know what? I liked Metallica before, but I wasn't heavily into them.
Right.
When the Black Album came out,
it's a good album.
I was like, ooh, I love this album,
yeah,
right? And
right.
Then I went into their old stuff and said, okay, now I know.
You discovered more.
I discovered more. And it probably brought in so many more listeners to their music.
Yeah.
Like, and it's why are you shitting on them, man, for that album? It's weird.
Ignorance.
But I'm surprised that coming from you that Kenny G, that's awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. How about best bass player of all time?
Oh, man.
Come on.
Yeah,
come
man.
On.
You know what? I have to say, I know, look, it's not a rock guy. Like, I love so many different bass players, but one guy that just like, you know, when you listen to music, there's some songs that give you goosebumps, and sometimes like it makes you want to cry. I swear, I was listening to an Italian song the other day, and I started like tearing up because it was so beautiful.
Holy shit!
But yeah, I think it was "Rose, Rose per te." It was very, very nice. I don't know. I always love that.
Wow!
Too. I love it.
You're freaking me out a bit.
I swear.
Okay.
God,
so
I
what?
Love
the bass
that.
Player on that?
No. But going back to bass players, there's one particular James Jamerson. There's one particular tune called "Darling Dear" by the Jackson 5, and that bass line just.
Okay, it gets you.
The
it
way
you.
It works with the melody, it just...
It hits you.
Oh, man, nice. It's nice. Beautiful. It's just beauty. Like a beautiful... or those
wow.
Beautiful sunflowers, which the viewers can't really see, but
they are there. They are beautiful.
Yeah, anyways, but yeah.
Okay,
it.
Cool. That's interesting. First thing that comes to mind when I say the Montreal music scene. First word, one word.
Look, I can't speak on behalf of the Montreal music scene because... I'm not in it as much as I used to, or I
well,
just
you're
like,
in it,
yeah, I'm in it in terms of like, yeah, corporate weddings.
The Montreal music scene
is like everything.
Everything, man.
Yeah, look, you know what? Sometimes I say like, if I was in Toronto, would it be better? Like the whole idea of like the grass is greener on the other side because, or being in the States. But then again, I think about like, there's just a lot more competition in Toronto. Population is bigger.
Of course.
In Montreal, I just wish a lot more musicians would. I don't mean to say this in an insulting way at all because I love all my musician friends, like nothing, but I just wish a lot of them would just open their eyes a bit more and just, you know, not do pass the hat or go play at these little cafes because it doesn't look too good, guys. It doesn't look too good.
I've always said that.
As mean as that sounds, it,
no, I've always said that.
Yeah.
We don't, a lot of times we don't respect ourselves.
Yeah.
Because we want to be out there, we want to play, and that's good.
But go play in your garage if you have to. Like, invite friends and, you know. I understand you want to play live, but it doesn't look good at the end of the
day. No, it's true because people know this. I mean, I book bands in a brasserie in LaSalle.
That's right, yeah.
And sometimes they want to play there so bad. And they're like, yeah, no, don't worry. We'll come for nothing. I'm like, dude, no, come on, man.
Refuse, man.
You can't.
Refuse.
You can't do that.
No.
You know, you can't do that. You got to, we're worth something. It's the amount of work that we do. It's got to be paid.
100%. The amount of hours. Yeah.
Again,
sorry. Yeah.
I love it. And when I say paid, I don't mean paid to play because I could do that all night. I mean paid to bring my gear.
Yeah.
Paid to load it up, do sound check, do this, and drive across the city.
100%.
That's what I want to get paid.
Bring your $7,000 bass
exactly.
And amplifier.
Okay, Celine Dion, first thought.
Oh, man. Like, honestly, I, you know, sometimes I always dreamed of playing with, like, one of these big
artists.
Singers and just backing them up on the bass. Look, I don't listen to Celine Dion enough to appreciate her music, mm-hmm. but I do know, like, you know, the few times I have listened to her, few songs, I should say, rephrase that. Man, I'm happy that she's from, you know, the province I was born in, being Quebec. Good. And, you know, the fact that, like, she had a residency in Vegas and, like, man, what a singer. What
she's
a singer.
Global. I mean.
And even the band she has, like, these men, it's women and men are just out of this world. Anyway, sorry, go on.
Okay, this is a good one. First thought.
Yes.
One word. When I say guitar players.
Eddie Van Halen.
Oh, okay. That's one guitar player.
Okay.
But what's your first thought on guitar players in general?
You know what? My first... Okay, can I say a phrase? It has to be like...
Sure,
like,
go ahead.
You know what? Look. Know your sounds, guys. Know your sounds. Don't show up with a $200 guitar with a little distortion pedal. Get your distortions, your fuzzes.
Do it at home, not on the gig.
Yeah, and don't play loud. Nobody wants to hear you blasting too loud. Come on.
I love it. Okay. What's the first thought? This is one word when I tell you the artist Drake.
Like, come on.
Please. Okay. Awesome. You know, I always bring this guy up because he's loved by so many. Yet, oh, he's such a good singer. I'm like, okay, I don't want to shit on him because what he does, look, he's popular.
Great for him.
It's amazing. But I mean, it's singing, kind of. I don't know. I don't know. I don't want to.
You know. I've had this. I wouldn't say argument. Let's say a nice discussion with an individual.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked the individual, "Who's your favorite singer?" And when I'm not gonna say whatever. When she said Drake. I said, well, hey, you know, like, who Freddie Mercury is?
Yeah,
and, like,
exactly.
You know, Robert Plant and, I don't know, Alicia Keys and Mariah Carey, etc.
Look, he's got a good sound, I guess, and he's good rhythmically. I'll give him that.
Yeah.
But I just, like, you know, like we were talking about Celine Dion.
Yeah.
It's like.
Like, move over. I'm just, like, please.
Thank you. Okay.
Go to bed.
Last one here. Yeah. Best frontman of all time.
Like a frontman in terms of entertainment, or does that include like singing, vocal?
Who would you pick?
Best
front. You had to pick a frontman for your band.
Oh man, okay, that's a good question. Wow, there's so many people.
Yeah, pick one.
I don't know, Steven Tyler, Aerosmith.
Steven Tyler, okay.
I guess Steven.
2 weeks in a row, the last guys that I had on the show.
Steven Tyler is good. I don't know, like, his personality, if he's like a cocky guy or anything.
He's crazy. He's fucked.
Yeah,
up.
Yeah, but like not super young Steven Tyler. I wanted being like. You know,
like
on
men?
Drugs and everything when he's on stage, but like later Steven Tyler, probably when he has like his daughter.
Okay.
He's
more than
more...
Freddie Mercury.
No, Freddie Mercury is good, but that's it. It's a hard question.
Hard
okay. Yeah, there's so many.
Okay, I'm good with that. Okay, that was our game.
Oh, nice. I had fun.
I love that.
Yeah,
I love it.
It's
fun.
Yeah, yeah.
And then this is another segment I do every week.
Okay.
It's called Worst Gig Ever.
I have it right clicked.
Do you have it? Okay, because we all have these stories, right?
Yeah.
And I love to hear it. I've heard quite a few funny stories.
Okay.
And you weren't there, one of them. My brother was on the show. And
I was there? Oh, no.
No,
sorry,
you weren't there. It was
here.
Before you came, you started playing with us.
Okay.
Yeah, and just to break it to you quickly,
go,
New Year's Eve.
Yeah, I know this story.
I told you the story, right?
10 times, but yeah, go for it.
Gotcha. I mean, they've heard it already. It's a fucking huge brawl.
Yeah,
I would
be scared if I saw it. I'm not going to lie.
It was not fun.
So,
worst gig ever. Tell me.
Well, you know what? One that pops in my head. Excuse me. I was playing at this place called like Hudson.
I just thought of one.
What? Was I there?
Yes.
I was there?
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, listen, I got to tell this quickly. Before you say yours, I got to tell this quickly. So I'm playing with Dan's band.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's stressed because it's a big...
like usual.
Was it a wedding? I think it was a wedding.
It was a wedding.
We're playing a wedding. And he's super stressed. He wants to make the client happy. It was one of the first big band weddings.
Yeah.
And I just got this new gear. Okay. I got new gear.
Now I know what you're talking about.
We got new wireless. I don't think it's worst gig ever. Because if it is, I feel really bad.
It was actually a really good gig. But
It wasn't worst gig ever. It was a funny moment.
Yeah.
So basically, I got new gear. I got this new keyboard. And it's wireless. And I'm having a blast with it. And we're on stage. We play our set. And when we take a break, the best man has to give a speech, right? So the band is standing there and we're kind of going to take a break. So the best man starts saying his speech and, you know, the whole hall.
Like, good evening, everybody.
Good evening, everybody. And the crowd, everyone's quiet. And all of a sudden, I turn off my wireless gear. Yeah. Now, if anyone who knows wireless gears, for some reason, when it wasn't muted,
everyone's scared to turn it off for this reason.
Now I'm scared. I turn off the belt pack. Not knowing that when it turns off and you're not muted, if there's no connection, basically every company is different. Most of the times it doesn't do this, but this time it just, this humongously loud noise
comes.
This distortion goes through the sound system, like, and Dan is like, what the fuck?
You know, like a cartoon, you just see the sweat like come down.
300 people are holding their ears.
And then it stops and you hear a baby crying. Like, I'm just like, oh my God.
So everything, the noise, I figured out it was, I'm like, fuck, I turn it off. And then all you hear is a baby going, like,
at that point, I just turned my mic. I just walked away. I'm like, okay, I don't know.
Dan had 10 heart attacks.
You had music, please.
And of course, I did the classic, I don't know what happened.
Yeah.
I was pretending like I had nothing to do with it. But it was all me. Anyhow, and needless to say, by the way, the band is all Dan's age. I'm a little bit older. I'm like 2 years older. He's 27. I'm only 2-3 years older than them. But I am the oldest. What? Why is everyone laughing?
Well, you and Sergio.
Okay, me and Sergio, we're a little bit older than these guys.
It's 19 years difference.
And with all the experience that I have over them, I was the fucking idiot who caused that disaster.
Well, let's put it this way. Ever since then, nobody turns off anything.
Exactly. And he tells us, don't shut anything off.
Yeah, exactly.
Worst gig ever.
My worst gig, it was this place in Hudson. It was at a time when I was like, I was in school and, you know, the company wasn't really working much. Let's put it this way. All jokes aside, I was desperate for work. It's one of those like month of November, really desperate. I took anything. And I was doing like these pub gigs and this band was just horrible. Just horrible. I can't believe
it. I remember this.
Yeah. Just horrible. Like, it makes me cry when I think about it. The drummer was just, you know? And like at that point, I'm like, okay, let me just smile. Let me just play because whatever. I needed the money. Okay, whatever. One of those situations. So we get to this sketchy bar in Hudson. Just drove from RDP. If nobody knows what RDP is, let's put it this way. It's very far. It's like a full tank of gas to get from RDP to Hudson. Let's just put it that way. I'm driving my little Mazda 3 manual, like full throttle on the 40 West. You know, like, I got to get there, you know. And so I get to the gig. I'm not going to call it the job. It was like, ugh. Anyways. Uh-huh. So I get there and like one of these sketchy little bars. You can imagine nobody in there. You know, the random old man playing the slot, smoking his Demoree cigarette in the back. And you're like, hold on, can you smoke inside? But I'm not going to say anything before I get beaten up or something. So we start playing and the owner of the place comes out like after the first set. And at this point, we're supposed to play like 9 to 1 in the morning. And I'm like getting paid. I didn't even know what it was. Like, I didn't remember whatever it was. This doesn't matter. And, the owner comes out and says, well, guys, you know, here's the money and, you know, you don't have to play anymore. You know, there's nobody in here. I said, hey, great. Fantastic. I throw out my bass and clip. Ciao. I start like, you know, putting away my stuff. I'm like, yeah, good. I'm going to go home and that's it. And the drummer at this point, first of all, like he's drunk. Like that's a big no-no to do that when you're, that's another like, how do I say it? It's a pet peeve, but like a wrong idea that people have about musicians. First of all, not everybody drinks. Like I don't even drink, even though, you know, I'm just sipping a beer, but I'm like slowly like drinking it. But whatever. This guy was drunk. And as I'm packing, he goes to me and says, where are you going, dude? And this guy's like my father's age, like 58 years old. You know, I'm just like, okay, hold on. At the time, I was like 20, you know, and, uh-huh. or 21. And he's like, where are you going? I'm like, well, we're supposed to stop, right? The owner says, he's like, no, we're not going anywhere. But I'm like, there's nobody in here. Why would we be playing? There's nobody. He's like, yeah. Am I able to swear on this?
Yeah, of course.
He's like, where the fuck do you think you're going, man? I'm the fucking boss. Take your bass and play that goddamn fucking bass.
Are you serious?
And this guy's like 6'4", like a big guy. And I'm like, okay. No. I'm like, so I just plugged in my bass and I'm just like, okay, man, just shut your mouth. And I'm like, not the biggest guy. I'm like, you know, what am I? Like 5'10", 145 pounds
are
max.
Are you serious?
And I'm just like, yeah, I never told you the story.
No.
I did. Yeah, I know I didn't.
Oh, I did. Maybe you did.
Yeah, I probably did, but it's a while. I don't repeat it. And let's put it this way. Ever since then, I don't accept that kind of stuff anymore.
Yeah.
That shit, I just walk away. And even that, I would even be playing.
So you guys played
like
a set just for...
We play, and we don't finish the night. At that point, I'm like, okay, let me just shut my mouth because this guy's obviously wasted and he's going to literally kick my ass.
Oh, my God.
So very aggressive.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
That I can imagine that set. Terrible.
Yeah. That's not fun when you're dealing with fools like that.
So Dan, where can we find Soul Station? Where can we find you?
Soul Station Orchestra, you can find the company on Instagram, of course. Please go check out the platform. You can find our website at www.soulstationorchestra.com. Facebook, but of course, Facebook, you know, doesn't always work. And of course, YouTube. And you can find me on Instagram, Stanny Slap Bass, where you can see, you know, my very cool Buick Skylark.
Nice.
And some bass videos that that I do. So
sweet.
Thank you very much,
Dan. Give me a little groove. I'm gonna give the conclusion here while you're with a little groove here.
Okay. So
guys, Sessions with Stef. I'd like to thank Danny, Mr. Slap Bass, Daniel DiCintio. Thanks for listening to another episode. This is a lot of fun. I kind of want to break into a song. But thank you, guys. Every bi-weekly Sessions with Stef, different musicians coming on. And check out Likumbari on YouTube. This podcast and all our podcasts, Talk It Out, is another podcast that's on our channel. You can find on Apple Podcasts. You can find on Spotify, any platform that has podcasts. We are there. Thank you so much for everything. JJR Studios, once again, everyone here, Lisa, Luigi, and Francesca. Guys, I had a blast. Daniel, thanks again for being. I want to like start playing drums or keys. I don't know. I just want to play. Thank you so much, guys. Have a good night. And till the next one. Ciao.